help you?
Hello, yeah, I've just seen somebody stabbed.
Where?
With two guys having a fight, and I saw a guy in a Range Rover pull a knife out of his right-hand pocket and stab the guy in a red van in the chest.
At the Old Bailey, Kenneth Noy was convicted of the murder of 21-year-old Stephen Cameron. It's the latest bloody twist in a criminal career of bewildering contradictions.
He's known to be violent and intelligent, which is a dangerous combination.
A charmer with a volcanic temper, he's a clever businessman, always on the lookout for a nude scam.
We always knew he was sort of halfway, there was a secret side to him, but you didn't really want to ask.
A multi-millionaire and a Freemason, who then killed a policeman.
There are villains who'll buy him a drink every time he goes in a pub because he's killed a policeman.
For real, because who ain't got no feelings, feelings.
Just watch my back, I got your front.
Check it out now. Stuck off the realness, we be the infamous, you heard of us. Official Queensbridge murderers, the mob comes equipped for warfare. Beware of my crime family who got enough shots to share for all those who wanna profile and pose. Rock you in your face, stab your brain with your nose bone. You all alone in these streets, cousin. Every man for himself in his land, we be gunning. And keep them shook crews running like they supposed to. They come around, but they never come close to. I can see it inside your face, you're in the wrong place. Cowards like you just get their whole body laced up with bullet holes and such. Speak the wrong words, man, and you will get touched. You could put your whole army against my team, and I guarantee you it'll be your very last time breathing. Your simple words just don't move me. You're minor, we major. You're all up in the game and don't deserve to be a player. Don't make me have to call your name out. You're cool as featherweight. My gunshots will make you levitate. I'm only 19, but my mind is older. When the things get for real, my warm heart turns cold. Another nigga deceased, another story gets told. It ain't nothing really. Ayo, done sparked the Philly. So I could get my mind off these yellow back niggas. While they still alive, I don't know. Go figure. Meanwhile, back in Queens, the realness and foundation. If I die, I couldn't choose a better location. When the slugs penetrate, you feel a burning sensation. Getting closer to God in a tight situation now. Take these words home and think it through. Or the next rhyme I write might be about you, Sunday shook. Cause ain't no such thing as halfway crooks. Scared to death and scared to look, they shook. Cause ain't no such thing as halfway crooks. Scared to death and scared to look. Living the life that is diamonds and guns. There's numerous ways you can choose to earn funds.
Crime and Justice TV, the study of criminal justice in a postmodern world, a modern thinker's perspective. Crime and Justice TV, broadcasting from Brixton in South London, United Kingdom. I don't got time for your petty thinking, my son, I'm bigger than those. Claiming that you pack heat, but you're scared to hold. And what the smoke clears you... Pepsi Watson, Crime and Justice TV. Good evening, everybody. So this video is about the release, only 2 days ago, on the 6th of June 2019, of Kenny Noy. Kenny Noy served 20 years for what was reported by the media as a road rage killing. The victim was Stephen Cameron, who was 21 years old. Kenny Noy was sentenced to a mandatory life sentence with a tariff or minimum term of 16 years. The release of Kenny Noy has triggered a debate in the upper echelons of the self-proclaimed criminal justice commentator Jurassic Park Dinosaur Land. Also, mainstream media are all over this case, as per usual, consistent with their agenda of targeting high-profile criminal cases to sow mass hysteria, feeding the very lifeblood of the hysterical media stridence and sophism that continues to destroy our decaying and embarrassing revenge state-era penal system. All to push specific political ideologies, and above all, to sell newspapers for profit, doing so without a shred of decency or any respect for the victim and the victims of this murder. And I'll get back to that shortly. So Kenny Noy has an extensive criminal history dating back to only 5 years old, when his mother caught him stealing money out of the till in a Woolworths store while his mother was talking to the cashier. Kenny Noy became a police informant and was such for many years, forming special bonds and relationships with many corrupt police officers. Kenny Noy became a Freemason in January 1980, becoming a member of the Hammersmith Lodge in London after being proposed for admission by two police officers, giving his occupation as a builder. One of Noy's police contacts persuaded a customs official not to target him. While his tip-offs to the Metropolitan Police's flying squad were reportedly a means to prevent competition from rival criminals. Active as a fence, Noy was among those involved in laundering a huge quantity of stolen gold bullion taken during the Brinks Mat robbery by six armed men on the 26th of November 1983. While he was being investigated for his involvement in the crime, Noy fatally stabbed Detective Constable John Fordham, who was involved in the police surveillance of Noy in the grounds of his home. Noy was acquitted of murder on the grounds of self-defense in December 1985. He was found guilty in July 86 the following year of handling some of the stolen gold and of a conspiracy to evade VAT. The discovery of the bullion had surprised the gang as they expected to find $3 million in cash. Their contacts had no experience of dealing with gold, let alone 6,800 bars worth $26 million in 1983. Mick McAvoy, one of the thieves, had asked Brian Perry to conceal the gold he had received, and it was Perry who brought in Noy and John Palmer, subsequently nicknamed Goldfinger. Palmer was acquitted in 1987 of knowingly handling gold from the robbery. Noy had melted down much of the Brinks Mat gold he had received and mixed it with copper coins in an attempt to disguise its origins, although 11 gold bars from the robbery were found hidden at his home. Sentenced to 14 years and fined £500,000 with £200,000 costs, he was released from prison in 1984, having served 8 years. In a civil action brought by the loss adjusters of Brinks Mat Insurers, $3 million was recovered from Noy while he was incarcerated. While serving this 14-year sentence in HMP Swaleside, the word is on the prison grapevine that he kitted out the gym, he bought all top-of-the-range equipment for the gym. He was very well respected as a prisoner there. There's also rumours that when he attended a funeral in handcuffs with prison officers from Swaleside, which is a BCAT training, you know, fairly high secure prison, that he was taken to his home with the prison officers and enjoyed a meal there with the prison officers and his close family. There are stories around the murder, different versions. You know, there's stories floating around that Stephen Cameron was a drug dealer, that he owed Kenny money. The media portrayed it as a road rage killing. But there's stories going around that he owed Kenny money, he was a drug dealer, the victim, Stephen Cameron. There's stories and different witness testimonies as to who pulled the knife out. Some saying Kenny pulled it out first, some saying that Kenny took it off Stephen Cameron and it was Stephen Cameron who pulled out the knife first. Other testimony and stories suggest that after an argument at the car door of Stephen Cameron, Noy returned back to his own car to collect a knife and then came back to Stephen Cameron's car and then fatally stabbed him. So there's different stories about what really happened. So the hysterical media
the son have been hiding in trees and bushes for the past 2 years to catch a photo of Noy leaving prison on temporary day release. The son also contacted Cameron's family, digging up pain, digging up trauma, and digging up suffering. All to sell newspapers for profit and to push political ideology without a shred of consideration for the victims. The Sun has also, for the past 2 years, been attempting to hijack Kenny Noy's parole hearing to achieve parole hearing or trial by media or social media, as is the case in 2019, to sabotage Kenny Noy's parole hearing and prevent release. Kenny Noy's successful release decision for release is a victory against the hysterical media stridents and sophism that continues to destroy our once great justice system. The fundamental foundation and very core of the parole board must be and must continue to be its independence. Kenny Noy was sent to a DCAT prison, you know, in the last 2 or 3 years, where these Sun News reporters have been targeting him. So the reason that he is would have been in a DCAT was because a three-member parole board would have conducted a rigorous assessment of risk, and they would have heard from various different expert witnesses, including forensic psychologists, veteran forensic psychologists, been in the game 25, 30 years, and they would have all agreed that Kenny Noy's risk could be managed in a semi-open prison. And I must point out here the immense difficulty in achieving parole and being a model prisoner to get released from a mandatory life sentence. You don't ever have the luxury of being able to have a bad day. You've got to be, you know, you have to meet that near impossible expectation of being the perfect person all the time, every hour of every day, 7 days a week. You have to be respectful, courteous and polite to staff at all times, male and female, not just prison officers, but chaplains, education officers, IMB people, all the staff, the workers, the DIY men that you see around the prison governors, which you don't see a lot, but you have to be respectful and courteous to them. You have to be clean and well presented, and you have to, you know, take care of your appearance and look after your cell. You have to work in training prisons, which Kenny Noy's been in for many, many years. You don't have a choice. You have to work. So you'll have had to do all these things. Kenny Noy will have had to complete a wide range of offending behavior programs, cognitive thinking behavioral programs, victim empathy programs like victim awareness, sycamore tree. He will have had to engage in some kind of therapy. There would have been a lot of work, offender behavior work, that he will have been instructed to do by the probation service. He would have had to work on kind of instrumental violence stuff, his pro-criminal thinking. He would have had to have addressed the entrenched criminality and his criminal beliefs and attitudes that have been active and thriving in Kenny Noy for his whole life. You know, this stuff was entrenched in Kenny Noy. And the fact that he's not only been successful in his application to go to a DCAT, he's then managed himself in a DCAT semi-open prison, which is not easy because they're full of drugs, they're full of people doing short sentences who don't care if they get kicked out. So they're messing around with mobile phones and stuff like that. Kenny would have had to stay away from all of that kind of stuff and to continue to be a model prisoner and to continue to prove that he's addressed the lifestyle, not just the offence, the lifestyle leading up to the index offence of fatally stabbing Stephen Cameron on the M25. So I can't reiterate enough just how difficult and how hard it is for year after year after year after year after year, you know, to be a model prisoner. So many lifers and indeterminate sentence prisoners, you know, they're good for years and years and years and years, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 years. And then before parole, they get one adjudication, one governor's report for a mobile phone or failing a drug test or being rude to an officer or stealing something from the workshop. And it's a 2-year knockback. You know, it's a 2-year knockback. And then that can be a downward slope, you know. That can lead to another 4 years in prison, another 6 years, 8 years in prison. So the fact that Kenny has achieved progression to a DCAT and then ultimately progression again via a three-member, very risk-averse, experienced parole panel, release into the community, he deserves some credit for that. He deserves some credit for that. So Kenny has earned his release within the punitive frameworks of the sentence handed down by the Crown Court in which he was sentenced. If anybody in society has an issue with Kenny's release, then my suggestion would be to blame the Crown Prosecution Service and the Sentencing Advisory Panel and lobby your MPs for a change to sentencing in regards to the sentencing tariffs for the crime of murder. If someone killed someone in my family and then 20 years later, 16 years later, they're walking down the road, you know, I can't imagine how I'd be feeling. You know, is this time for a debate? Should life mean life? It's 15 years for murder, 16-year tariff that he got. It does shock people. It does shock people. I mean, since Kenny Noy was sentenced, I mean, since that around about that time in 2000, there has been a change in the guidelines around murder. I mean, the minimum term for murder is 15 years if you're over the age of 21. If you're under the age of 21, the minimum starting point is 12 years. So, but to get a 15-year minimum term for tariff this day and age in 2019 for murder, there's got to be hardly any aggravating features at all. It's very rare that people get 15, 16 year tariff minimum terms now for murder. I mean, it's 30 year minimum term for gun murders. Any knife murder is always going to attract a minimum term of around 25 years, even 30. Any murder with a sexual or sadistic motive is going to cop you a 30 year minimum term. Any murder involving a police officer or a prison officer or a child is going to be minimum 30 years. You can possibly get whole life tariffs for those kind of murders as well, especially if there's a sexual element in the child murder. Ian Huntley, when he was sentenced to his minimum term, the main thing that prevented the sentencing judge from sentencing him to a whole life tariff, life without parole, was that they just could not prove, the prosecution could not prove that there was a sexual element with the murder of those two little girls, Holly and Jessica. So, yeah, I mean, most murders in this day and age in 2019 do attract 30-year minimum terms, 25-year minimum terms. But that would be my suggestion. You know, it's easy to be angry at Kenny and to blame Kenny because of the outrage of what happened and the murder of a young man. But I'm just trying to invite you to look at the bigger picture and put the blame where it lies. Which, you know, if you think there should be longer sentences, then lobby the parliament and the people who deal with the sentence, to deal with the sentences. And the reason I mentioned the Crown Prosecution Service is because the Crown Prosecution Service in England and Wales are pussycats. They're like the little black and white cats off the Felix adverts that you used to see years ago, all cuddly and soft, yeah? Federal prosecutors and district attorneys in the United States of America, they would have made mincemeat out of the Stephen Lawrence killers. They wouldn't be up on the continent trafficking narcotics like they have been of recent years. You know, they'd have been locked up for 30 to life, yeah, a long, long time ago. And so would the police officers who were in bed with one of the fathers of the Stephen Lawrence killers. They'd have been locked up for 15 to 20 years as well. But over here in this country, the CPS, you know, they're pussycats. The CPS would have had enough, could have had enough on Kenny Noy to put him away for him to never see the light of day again, but they just didn't do it. So you can't blame Kenny. Blame the CPS. I mean, Kenny Noy was knee-deep in everything in the underworld. I mean, there was nothing he wasn't involved in the underworld in Britain. But, you know, the CPS just, they put one murder on him. That was it. That's what they put on him. And the sentence for that was 16-year minimum term. He served that sentence and more, and he's been released. So I said at the start of the video, we have a dinosaur Jurassic Park mentality, self-proclaimed criminal justice commentators playing God and commentating on this release decision of Kenny Noy. So the people I'm talking about are men like former prison governor Ian Acheson and also former chief of the parole board, Nick Hardwick. Hardwick was sacked over the John Warboys saga, so isn't really in a position to comment on the release of people convicted of murder. And on that point about John Warboys, again, I reiterate, if the Crown Prosecution Service had done their jobs properly at the time when John Warboys was going through the court procedures, then they would have been able to put him away for enough time that John Warboys would have never, ever seen the light of day ever again. They had 86 other offences, mainly rapes, drugging the women and sexual assaults, and they just, you know, casually and half-heartedly concluded that these offences didn't pass the threshold of a likelihood of conviction in the Crown Court. Well, that's not good enough, because everybody at the time knew that John Warboys was responsible for over 100 black cab taxi rapes in the capital, and you charge him in the end with a measly 19 offences, only one rape and 18 other offences of assaults, sexual assaults and drugging, and then he gets an 8-year tariff. He gets an IPP life sentence with an 8-year tariff, and then you're complaining when he's trying to get released and applying for release 8 or 9 years later. Well, of course he's going to apply for release and try and orchestrate his release via the parole board by manipulating people and displaying and showing the same exact Index Offence Commission related behaviours and attitudes that he showed in manipulating and sexually assaulting women. Of course he's going to do that, because you've given him the opportunity to do that. If John Warboys was in America for those offences, federal prosecutors and district attorneys, John Warboys would have never seen the light of day ever again, yeah? So this is a big problem, and I would say to the British government, you know, that's where you need to spend some money and to put some resources into strengthening the formidability of the Crown Prosecution Service, because they are pussycats, and it's just not good enough. The public deserve better. The public deserve better than that. So these men, Hardwick and Acheson, they're always commentating on parole board release decisions, playing God with their outdated Jurassic Park dinosaur mentality, counterproductive rhetoric. A rhetoric which in fact actually harms the principles of justice and harms achieving of proportionate justice for victims of crime, and they are a disease in the criminal justice system and in no way represent the modern thinking required to spearhead the necessary changes required to reform our outdated penal system and reduce recidivism. A criminal justice revolution which the foundation of will be victim focused. Dinosaurs like Ian Acheson and Nick Hardwick are part of the problem, not part of the solution. For as long as we continue to demonize, then the opportunity to understand and inspire reform and to prevent further similar crimes happening again is missed and dismissed. And the opportunity to inspire personal responsibility and repentance and change within the individual, I would say so as well. This is the case for the shoplifter, to the killer, to the paedophile, the terrorist, or even the child killer. Our decaying, outdated justice system is perpetrator and culpability obsessed, and so the wider social and other influences active in Index Offence Commission are always missed, as are the socio-economic influences. More importantly, the demographic that suffers greatly from the culpability and perpetrator-obsessed penal system is victims of crime. Modern thinkers need to grab this endemic cultural problem and catapult these issues to the forefront of penal reform. Academia, training for prison officers, mental health workers, and also police officers, and up-and-coming next-generation grassroots politicians. Stephen Cameron's family are said to be absolutely devastated at the release of Kenny Noy. They have said that life should mean life. So we should have that debate. Should life mean life? There's an argument to have that debate because there's no platform for victims' voices. I was speaking to somebody recently about doing a podcast, doing a project with them about domestic violence and that you know, there's no platform for people, victims of domestic violence, male and female, to have a voice. You've got the victim charter, and victims are entitled to compensation and stuff like that. But this obsession with perpetrator and culpability in our decayed, outdated, draconian Victorian justice system, it's got to stop. And there's got to be a revolution, and this revolution has got to be victim focused. So Stephen Cameron's family have got a right to have their voices heard, and they should be given a platform to have that voice heard, because they're being re-traumatized right now with the release of Kenny Noy. So because dinosaur commentators like Hardwick and Acheson, in their relentless self-righteous demonizing of the convicted, feeding that perpetrator and culpability disease, which inevitably continues post-release and becomes... And because many people follow, these established people like Hardwick and Acheson, the opportunity for the greater cause of good is missed. I'm going to give you an example of what I mean by missed, yeah? So there's a prison channel across the pond called Life After the Penitentiary, and the guy who runs it is called Big Herc. Big Herc spent many years in prison, and he's changed his life around, and he now does a prison channel and tries to spread a message out to the world that prison is not worth it, crime's not worth it, the fast cash is not worth it, drugs are for mugs, it's not worth it. And he's been very successful. He's got a few hundred thousand subscribers. So I watch Big Herc's videos maybe once a week. I'll watch like two or three of his videos. And he's had a guy on recently by the name of Wes Watson. And this production was absolutely outstanding. This production by Life After the Penitentiary, Big Herc with Wes Watson. Now, listening to this interaction between these two men, so Wes Watson had spent 10 years in custody, yeah, in level 2, 3, and 4 prisons in America. He'd got onto weed at 12, 13 years old, and then he started, you know, selling it because he didn't want to pay for it. He wanted it for free. And I could relate to that story because I started smoking cannabis and weed at 12, 13. Very, very similar story. Really, really sort of hit me just how similar our stories were. And what's interesting about this video is that Wes Watson doesn't need to mention or talk about victim empathy or go into too much detail about the harms that he caused society in America, even though he did touch on the harms that he'd caused a few times, but he didn't really expand on it, and he didn't need to. He didn't need to, because this is why it's such a beautiful production, because words are a dime a dozen, actions mean louder than words, and change or reform or repentance is not the verses and choruses that one may beautifully articulate from the rooftops. Yeah, change and reform and repentance and making amends to victims and people that you've harmed is a way of life. Yeah, it's a way of life. And Wes Watson was just a great example of everything I've just said, you know, that transformational change. He was a great example for it. So he didn't need to give it the big talk and say, you know, oh, my victims, I'm doing this to help my victims and all that kind of stuff. Because his own example, which is the best example, his own example, you know, was what was showing and displaying all of that change. Incredible, absolutely outstanding production. Wes Watson is well-spoken, he is courteous, well-mannered, polite, he's respectful. He's an example of personal responsibility and making that change. There was no blaming, no denial. He was an open book, transparent, humble, and he you could see, and you can see on his Instagram and by the things that he's saying, that he's somebody who values being loving and kind and supportive to those around him. In fact, he said that that was his priority every day. Like, it's just amazing, like how being kind and loving and looking out for others in that selfless nature where he puts others first, you know, that is the highlight of his day. But at the same time, you know, he's not a doormat. If he has to put a boundary down, he will put a boundary down, like he mentioned and he spoke about in the gym where the guy's laughing. But here's the beauty, like, not just putting the boundary down with the guy in the gym and saying to him, you know, like, look, I didn't see a mirror for 10 years, so this is a positive place and I'm enjoying it. You know, putting the boundary down and that assertiveness, but doing it a way where he's communicating wisdom, yeah? Doing it in a way where he's communicating wisdom. You know, you don't get there. You don't get to that. You know, this stuff I'm talking about with Wes Watson, you don't get to that place without going on a long, long, long journey of pain, suffering, going to hell and back a few hundred times, rigorous self-examination, repentance. You just don't get there without going on that journey. You know, again, like Wes Watson, he's the example, not the chorus from the rooftops. The discipline that he shows, the strength of character on his Instagram, getting up at 4 o'clock every morning, the discipline and resolve and strength of character and positive mental attitude and positive self-talk that is involved in looking the way that he looks is it's incredible. Make no mistake, that discipline is the same discipline that is required for Roger Federer to win 20 grand slams. Yeah, it's exactly the same. Yeah, it's just they've both had different life experiences and, you know, there's luck involved, being at the right place at the right time, strong parenting, all that kind of stuff, you know. And that was Roger Federer's path and that was Wes Watson's path. That's just how it is. And that discipline is on show from this interview with Wes Watson and Big Herc to children all over the world. And I think that is inspiring and is incredible. He talks about purpose, not pleasure. Yeah. He talks about the relentless pursuit of purpose will cultivate happiness in your life. And I love that. I love that. It's so important. It's so important with desistance from crime, trying to break away from the revolving door of the penal system. It's relevant to PTSD sufferers, sexual abuse sufferers, mental health sufferers, addiction, purpose, a reason to get out of bed every morning. Wes Watson talks about that relentless pursuit of purpose, yeah, that will cultivate your own happiness. I've got nothing but admiration and respect for both Wes Watson and Big Herc for this outstanding and unrivaled production on Life After the Penitentiary. It was one of the most powerful interactions between two men that I've ever seen. I watched it three times, and I watched the, because he's got a shorter interview on the channel, I watched that twice. I watched the same video three times because I was so blown away by it. The the delivery of the message to children, to drug addicts, to people with mental health, like I said, PTSD sufferers, anyone who suffers, you know, it was off the charts. This message was off the charts. And there's no pill, there's no medication involved. I mean, how unreal is that? Like, this example of change is massive. The change that we on display here from Wes Watson and Big Herc in terms of proportionate justice for victims. You cannot change the past, only the future. You can't go back in time. So we make amends to our victims by being the example that Wes is, to self-examine, that rigorous self-examination, to go to those painful dark places, to contribute to society and help society, as opposed to what we used to do, which was to harm society. To be a role model, to inspire children, to be the best version of me every day. And yeah, I'm human, I'm flawed, I make mistakes, but progress, not perfection. Can I be a little bit better today than I was yesterday? To grow daily, to grow in understanding and effectiveness, to love by recognizing myself in others. But to get to a place like that, I have to learn to love me first. I have to learn to love myself. Any school teachers that have kids in detention, take the books off them, take the lines off them, and show them that video of Wes Watson and Big Herc. Any parents who's worried about their children, they're getting into trouble, staying out late at night, maybe experimenting with drugs, lock them in a house, get a big TV and put that video on the TV and sit your children down in front of that TV. Police officers taking little kids into custody in America, in Canada, in anywhere, Australia, Sri Lanka. Don't put them in a cell. Put them in a room with a big TV and put that video of Wes Watson and Big Herc on and make them watch that, yeah? It's you know, I'm really passionate about this because it's something I feel really strongly about, because it's very rare that you see something like this in when you're living and experiencing a criminal justice system that is so negative, so perpetrator and culpability obsessed, you know, where the victims of crime get missed and the opportunities for men who've been there and done it, like Wes Watson, 10 years, you know, down, the opportunity is very rare that a platform is given to people like that to use the experience to help. But not just help on a small scale, but help on a potentially global scale to inspire children all over the world. It's very rare. So that's why I'm passionate about this video that I've seen. And that's why I'm talking about it here on my channel on this Kenny Noy video. So big shout out, big love, big respect to Big Herc and Life After the Penitentiary YouTube channel. And also big shout out, big love, big respect from here in London, Brixton, across the pond to Wes Watson. Keep climbing, enjoy the view, and keep progressing and moving forward, onwards and upwards. I'll put the link for that video in the description in this video. So carrying on with this theme of this the wisdom and experience that people like Big Herc and Wes Watson have got and are, you know, transferring it into society to make a positive difference to the world. The insight, experience and life experience Kenny Noy has and can offer children, not just in UK but around the world, is immeasurable. Put that on his life license conditions. You know, life license condition number 12, must spend the rest of your life going to schools and telling them about the dangers of drugs and crime and prison. Modern thinkers will also take note as to the opportunity for revolutionising the way in which license conditions for those leaving custody are structured and drawn up. Modern thinkers will put more emphasis on victims of crime in license conditions and more emphasis on what the released person who's coming back out into society can put back into society, as opposed to the current, which is an often very kind of rigid blanket license conditions, which are give or take just about the same for everybody. Modern thinkers will devise license conditions more geared to the individual, with the focus on victims of crime and a focus on contributing back into society. If Kenny Noy is watching this video, I will give you a platform. I'm happy to give you a platform. You're welcome into my home for food. We can share food. I'll give you a platform to inspire children all over the world. I'll give you a platform to put some good back into the world for the bad things that you've done. You can't change the past. You can only change the future. And I will also give a platform to any victims of crime. I'm happy to mediate. I am confident in my ability and my skill set to be able to pursue such activities. It's very important for me here at Crime and Justice TV to, and you know, with my mission of spearheading a global criminal justice revolution, which is victim focused. That is the fundamental cornerstone foundation of my revolutionary campaign, that the victim must be the center of that, you know. So if there's any victims of crime out there that want a platform and want a voice, you know, get in touch. I'll put my details in the description and we can make it happen. And yeah, that's my message, you know, for as long as we continue to demonize the opportunity for learning and understanding and mediation, reform, forgiveness, putting something back into society is entirely missed. So to children anywhere in the world, you know, I hope you've enjoyed this video, and I hope you can just take something away from it, and your education is the passport to your future. Don't make the same mistakes I did, the same mistakes Big Herc made, the same mistakes Wes Watson made, that Kenny Noy made. It's not worth it, and it will take you to hell and back 500 times. If you're already getting into trouble with the police, take stock of your life. Rigorous self-examination. Discover purpose, the purpose Wes Watson talks about. Purpose, not pleasure, and relentlessly pursue that purpose. That's what will lead to a happy life, not fast cash or the short-term buzz you get from recreational drugs. Love yourself. You're worth so much more than the harm that you are not only doing to others and people who love and care about you, but the harm that you're doing to yourself. Make skillful decisions, not unskillful decisions. Make decisions that help and benefit you and reward you, and not decisions that harm you and harm other people. Read books, take up sport, draw, paint, go fishing, nurture animals, take up motorsport, football, soccer, hockey, baseball, learn about engines, learn about aeroplanes, explore the outdoors, go camping, do fitness, workouts, weights, discover purpose. You get one chance at this life, one chance. Don't mess it up, don't blow it. And whatever you do choose, master your art. Genius is perseverance, yeah? Repetition, 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 practice, practice, practice. If I could take your pain away, I could, but I can't. And no matter where you are, you know, I'm inundated. I get messages from all over the world. My YouTube channel, you know, I don't make any money. It's very time consuming. But, you know, when I wake up with a message from a 15-year-old in Toronto saying, wow, your video inspired me. I mean, that to me is just, it's immense. It's absolutely just the best feeling. It's better than drugs, better than money. It makes me feel alive. It's an electric feeling, an overwhelming feeling of satisfaction, yeah, that my message has touched somebody in a different country and potentially helped them, a young person, a child who perhaps might be going down the wrong path. So wherever you are, Queens, Detroit, Brooklyn, Cali, I get messages from Finland, Thailand, Sri Lanka, South Africa, France, Melbourne, Australia, Sydney, wherever you are. If I could take your pain away, I could, but I can't. So there's personal responsibility. It's your choice, and it is a choice. You either allow your pain to dictate and determine a bad path for you and consume you, and, you know, like Wes says, that horrific existence, life without parole in a state penitentiary, you know, hell on earth, you know, it's worse than death. You know, that's if you don't kill yourself or overdose on drugs or die in a car crash, smashed out your face on drugs and alcohol. You know, it's a choice. It's a choice whether you go down that path and look at your pain, and or it's a choice whether you look at your pain and go to them dark, painful places you need to go to, and then channel that pain into purpose, into positive action, into skillful actions. Do good and you will do good to yourself. Do bad and you will do bad to yourself. Put that positivity out into the universe and it will come back tenfold. Yeah, if I'm good, kind, loving, generous, if I forgive others, if I help society and not harm society, all that comes back to me in abundance. It's a fact, the laws of attraction. It comes back to me not once, but tenfold. If I'm dishonest, deceitful, violent, a nasty person, harming people, that comes back to me. If I'm dealing drugs, putting that poison out onto the street, it all comes back to me tenfold. Yeah, big time. It comes back big league. Yeah. If you're struggling and you need help, reach out. You know, don't suffer in silence. That is my message today. Don't suffer in silence. Reach out in the comments. I've got, you know, great subscribers who've been through and continue to go through their own struggles. You know, we can all help you. We can do together what we can't do alone. You know, let's it's okay to ask for help. When I asked for help, my life changed immediately. Just like that, overnight. It changed immediately and my life's never been the same again. From the moment, from the day, the hour, the exact moment, the exact time when I asked for help, my life changed immediately. So ask for help. Reach out. Yeah, there's people who can help. So I'm going to wrap up this video. Again, you know, I reiterate, big shout out and big love to Big Herc and Wes Watson from across the pond here in London. Big shout out to YouTube channel Life After the Penitentiary. My offer still stands with Kenny Noy. If you're watching, I'll give you the platform to make a difference and contribute to society. My offer still stands for any victims of any crimes that and you feel you don't have a voice. I will give you that platform and I will give you that voice. And that's it. That's it for my Kenny Noy video. I hope you all enjoyed it. I hope you all got something out of it and found it positive in some way. The lights are gone, but there you go. That's just in the right time. But yeah, as always, I wish you all good health, prosperity, blessings, joy, all in abundance. And above all, may you love by recognizing yourself in others.
Crime and Justice TV, broadcasting from Brixton in South London, United Kingdom. Crime and Justice TV, the study of criminal justice in a postmodern world, a modern thinker's perspective.